I bring you greetings from Noosa, here in southeast Queensland, where I'm on holidays with my family as you enjoy yourselves in the wintry scenes in Switzerland. And I know that these scenes are familiar to some of you in the audience, Ben Chalicum, Matt Bultitude, who spent a lot of time here, so I do hope that you enjoy some of these memories with me during the talk today. Avoiding obsolescence? Avoiding obsolescence as a prostate cancer surgeon? Surely there must be some mistake. I'm in my prime. I've got my finger effortlessly on the pulse of prostate cancer. I'm a trend spotter. I'm a trend setter. Why has Christian asked me to talk about avoiding obsolescence as a prostate cancer surgeon? Aren't there other more vulnerable delegates there in Andermatt who should be considering obsolescence more acutely? Is that Roland Morley I see there in the back? Is that Gordon Muir, the master of the dark arts of BPH marketing? Surely one of those guys should be talking about obsolescence. So why me? Why has Christian Brown asked me to talk about this topic of avoiding obsolescence as a cancer surgeon? Well, despite my own strong self-belief in my immortal relevance in prostate cancer, I did turn 50 not so long ago, you know, about halfway through a consultant surgeon's career, so probably a good time to do a rain check and see, am I relevant? Am I prepared for the future? Am I doing the best I can for my patients? And my disclosure is that I still need to work for another 15 or 20 years, and therefore avoiding obsolescence is a high personal priority for me. And by way of background, I am a full-time prostate cancer specialist working at Peter MacCallum Cancer Centre in Melbourne, and I'm director of GU Oncology, so I have a multidisciplinary role in what is Australia's leading cancer centre. And therefore this topic of avoiding obsolescence is really important for me personally and professionally, and I hope you enjoyed the few thoughts I have on this topic today. Now, it is very clear that the cancer landscape is transforming in many different ways. We are seeing long-term survival in patients who otherwise would have lived for months not that long ago. We can now characterize cancer in a much more sophisticated manner, opening up much more precise, individualized options for patients. And the role of the surgical oncologist is also changing. Gross anatomy is no longer our only working space. So if you think about obsolescence in this fast-changing cancer landscape, it's all too easy to get left on the scrap heap. And the history of medicine is full of interventions which might seem almost comical now, but were not so at the time. For example, the rest cure was pioneered by Dr. Silas Mitchell in the latter half of the 19th century, mostly for women who were deemed hysterical, most likely for just sharing an opinion, I suspect. Rest cure involved the complete surrendering of autonomy. No more reading or writing or imagination or anything like that, and a good rest was thought to sort out the problem. Radiated water was thought to be an elixir of youth, a spark of life, and was also put into toothpaste. And there are many current practices which may look similarly egregious when we look back in a few years to come. Bloodletting, of course, by the barber surgeons was the widely accepted means of ridding the body of toxins. Insulin shock therapy was used for the treatment of schizophrenia right up to the 1960s. And cocaine drops were prescribed for a variety of mundane conditions, everything from headaches to depression, and almost certainly contributed to Freud's vivid dreams, and likely to some of Halstead's innovative surgery. Now, we laugh at these now, but what practices in prostate cancer in my and your lifetimes will be obsolete in years to come? Radical prostatectomy for low-risk prostate cancer. That constituted a very large number of the cases I did in the noughties at Guy's and elsewhere. What about surgery for intermediate-risk prostate cancer? I'm just not sure if that will even exist in anything like the same numbers by the end of this decade. So in preparing this video today, I decided to dig out my old record of basic surgical training from my two-year rotation through the Meath and Adelaide hospitals back in Dublin in the late 1990s. Have a look at that fresh-faced image of naive surgical enthusiasm. Where has it gone? Let me tell you that when I look through this logbook, I can confidently say this to you. The vast majority of the cancer operations that I participated in as a trainee are completely obsolete today. Dozens and dozens of mastectomy and axillary clearance procedures, which I am absolutely certain we would never countenance in any of these patients were they diagnosed today. Organ sparing surgery, targeted therapies, and multidisciplinary care has seen to that. So I say this to the young, and I know there are some trainees in the audience today. As you diligently record surgical procedures in your electronic logbook, be aware that the procedure that you put in there today has an extremely high likelihood of being obsolete by the time you get to my stage, only halfway through your surgical career. Obsolescence is something you need to consider at every stage of surgical training. A patient of mine gave me a print of this great painting a few years ago, and it sits in my office at home. It is, of course, Rembrandt's The Anatomy Lesson of Dr. Nicholas Tulp. Tulp was the official city anatomist in Amsterdam, and tradition was that he performed one public dissection per year, usually of an executed criminal, and that is the scene Rembrandt depicted here. But more of this later. Anyhow, let me take you through my top 10 tips for survival as a cancer surgeon. First, leave the cancer in there? Are you kidding me? I cannot think of any localized cancer that we diagnosed in my early surgical training that we did not cut out or try and irradiate. But now that is absolutely the norm for many cancers, even common cancers like breast cancer, rectal cancer, and obviously prostate and kidney cancer when diagnosed at an early stage. Every single low-grade prostate cancer which we diagnosed in the 1990s and early 2000s was treated with surgery or radiation. But now we know that that very clearly is not necessary for the vast majority of these cancers. And indeed, one of the greatest advances in prostate cancer over my past 20 years has been the recognition that very many patients can instead be offered surveillance. What does this mean for the surgeon, highly trained in prostatectomy, who loves this operation, and who derives a significant income from doing it? Well, my advice is to get with the program. Resistance is futile. Your patients will be much better off, and you know that you are a good clinician when you avoid overtreatment of these common cancers. Be an advocate for surveillance. Be a leader in the conservative management of early cancers. And then you might just survive, because if you don't, patients will go elsewhere and you will be sitting there in an empty operating room wondering, where did it all go wrong? My second tip is about imaging. Well, what happened? Imaging used to be our friend. The radiologist would find some abnormal lump and we would cut that lump out. And radiologists were certainly not involved in prostate cancer screening, as we just went straight to prostate biopsy when the PSA test was a bit abnormal. But now, of course, patients get an MRI scan when the PSA test is abnormal. And guess what? If the MRI scan is normal, the vast majority of patients do not need a biopsy. So the poor urologist doesn't even get to do the biopsy, let alone the unnecessary prostatectomy for the low-grade prostate cancer. Jeez. And this, by the way, is my own prostate MRI, so perhaps I should be grateful for having avoided a prostate biopsy, at least to date, thanks to imaging. These new imaging-directed triage pathways are now well-defined in many cancers and clearly lead to better outcomes for our patients, avoiding over-detection and increasing the accuracy of a subsequent biopsy. Plus, let's not forget our nuclear medicine colleagues. 10 years ago, all that nuclear medicine had to offer in prostate cancer was bone scanning, so-called unclear medicine. Now, the advent of PET imaging using prostate-specific membrane antigen, PSMA, has completely transformed the way we stage prostate cancer. There were many urologists involved in this prospective randomized trial that we published in The Lancet, demonstrating the superiority of PSMA, PET-CT in prostate cancer staging. So surgeons like us can really drive forward practice-changing research by embracing imaging, even if that sometimes means patients may not undergo surgery due to the metastases we've now demonstrated on a PET scan. So again, my messages are, do not resist. Support important research in these areas. Work with your imaging colleagues to refine these pathways, as indeed many of you in the UK have done. The radiologists should be grateful, of course, as it might help mitigate their otherwise impending inevitable obsolescence. Number three, more bad news on imaging. For our nuclear medicine colleagues are now not just imaging prostate cancer and changing the decisions we make, but they are also treating prostate cancer using radioligand therapy with amazing success. This has also been a fascinating and rewarding area of research for me to be involved with personally and professionally. And as we have taken this treatment from very advanced prostate cancer, as you see here with these MIP images of patients before and after treatment with lutetium PSMA in our center, a first-in-man study and subsequent randomized trial published last year, we are now also taking it into the localized prostate cancer space. I am PI on a neoadjuvant trial in which we give men lutetium PSMA prior to prostatectomy to see if we can knock out this cancer with some very interesting results soon to be presented at the EAU plenary. Provocatively, we call this the lutectomy trial. Could lutetium replace prostatectomy? Could I render myself obsolescent by my very own study? Well, let's see. My advice to cancer surgeons is to absolutely embed yourself with multidisciplinary colleagues. And that's not just radiation oncologists, medical oncologists, nurses, and so on, but especially radiologists and nuclear medicine physicians, for they have an incredible amount to offer as these technologies develop in prostate cancer. Number four, technology. Choose wisely is my message. Of course, all surgeons love technology. That's what we were brought up to do. And generally speaking, urologists in particular have tended to be early adopters of technology, occasionally even helping patients as we fiddle with that latest gadget. And naturally, fellowship training has often focused on whatever latest innovation is in vogue, and which you can then bring back to your own country or your own center. But the problem with early adoption is that winds can change quickly, and that new technology which you mastered on your fellowship may not prevail. Imagine, you have just returned from the poverty of doing a two-year fellowship in robotic gynecology in the USA. You are sitting in the coffee room about to do your first two cases back at home, feeling a little anxious, as there is plenty of pressure on you as you launch this program in your new hospital. Then, news breaks on the TV in the coffee room of a randomized trial in the New England Journal, clearly indicating that your operation is now obsolete. Oh dear. The message here has to be, do not focus on a single technology, especially in cancer. Do not do a fellowship in robotic whatever. Instead, do a fellowship focusing on a disease area, working in a multidisciplinary environment. That way, you are much less likely to become obsolescent. That is why our cancer center focuses on fellowships in, for example, GU oncology or lower GI oncology. And within that, of course, we have very high volume exposure to advanced surgical techniques. What we always encourage our trainees to do is keep their minds open and try and develop a broad set of skills applicable to that disease area. Undoubtedly, overseas fellowship training is incredibly valuable for cancer surgeons, but my advice to young trainees planning their fellowship is not to navel gaze on a particular technology or technique. Focus on the disease, not the device, and get into a top multidisciplinary oncology program that will keep you relevant for just a bit longer. Number five, research is one of the tools that you have at your disposal that may just prevent you from becoming obsolete anytime soon. And one of the few reasons why a cancer surgeon may still be useful in a few years' time is that we are the purveyors of cancer tissue, which means that researchers will always be interested in us. Although I am more of a clinician researcher than a scientific researcher, I do really value working with my scientific colleagues at Peter Mac, and it certainly enriches my own understanding of GU cancers to work on these translational programs. So if you have the opportunity, whether you're as a boss or a trainee, I strongly encourage you to do everything you can to work with your cancer research colleagues. It will personally enrich you, it will help your patients, and may just be the final thread that makes you useful in a future world where cancer surgeons are maybe an endangered species. Number six, manage your digital footprint. This is not optional. Let me ask you, how often do you Google yourself? Hands up for never. Hands up for once a year. Once a month. Every week. Well, you must, for that is what your potential patients, referrers, future trainees, future employers will do. Even if you are not someone whose natural inclination is to post a TikTok every morning, you must understand that you, as a doctor, have a digital footprint. Whether that is driven by academic work with your name associated with, or a health practitioner listing website, or your private hospital website, or whatever. And it is in your interest to add value to this footprint by enriching the content, the reach, the engagement of whatever it is that you do. There are simple and free things you can do, like make sure your LinkedIn page is updated, make sure the hospital website is accurate and has a picture taken of you from the past 10 years or so, but not too recently, mind. And certainly, if you are an academic, that you have a Google Scholar and ResearchGate profile. This is easy, this is free. Of course, if, like me, you are a big communications enthusiast, then the sky is the limit. You can build your own personal website, max out on social media, and get good followings on Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, and so on. Post content regularly and engage with your followers. Start a podcast, as we did a couple of years ago, which is a great distraction and gets many thousands of listeners from around the world every week. Any and all of these activities will significantly increase your digital footprint and buffer you from the ever-increasing threat of a negative review. Be in no doubt, a solid digital footprint is already an essential criteria to keep you relevant as a cancer surgeon in the 21st century. Even if your older or unwell patient is not likely to Google you and form an opinion, their son or daughter certainly will. Ignore this at your peril. Number 7, we're getting there. The multidisciplinary team. Now, I know that working within an MDT is now very standard practice, of course, in the UK, which pioneered many of these workings, and I know you're all very involved. So all I will say about MDT working is properly embed yourself in this. Be engaged, be a leader. And also think outside the box and ask, who else could be involved in my MDT to improve my patient's care? For me, embedding the nuclear medicine team in our prostate cancer MDT has been the single biggest change to our MDT in the past 6 or 7 years and has really helped us drive forward some significant practice-changing research in prostate cancer imaging and theranostics. It has been very fulfilling personally and professionally, and I know for sure that we have improved our patients' journeys as a result. So who else could help in your MDT? Think broadly and put your hand out. The other big change, of course, has been the move to hybrid meetings. I love when all the team are together in our MDT rooms at Peter Mac, but COVID has certainly taught us that using virtual platforms is extremely easy and allows people to engage fully without physically coming in. Hybrid MDTs are here to stay. And on that note, raising your game as a communicator is also something that the post-COVID world has brought to the fore. Content creation is not just something for influencers trying to avoid developing a real career and helping anyone other than themselves. Becoming an engaging communicator as a clinician now means developing the content creation skills that have transformed the lens through which the next generation is now seeing the world. We need to raise our game to stay relevant. Number 9, listen to your patients. The great Dr. Patrick Walsh, godfather of prostate cancer surgery, gave a memorable talk a few years ago in which he talked about the importance of listening to patients and how this has inspired him to make some very important advances in prostate cancer research. He also wrote about this very eloquently in European Urology in 2017. I really believe his messages, and I therefore do my best to listen to my patients. It can be very humbling to hear patients' experience, and I try and take everything I learn from past patients to improve the way I look after future patients. A simple philosophy, but one that might keep you relevant for just a little bit longer. Finally, number 10, and this is aimed at everyone, but especially consultants and more senior trainees. make surgery an attractive destination for female trainees. For the future survival of your specialty, for the betterment of you and your patients, you must do all you can to promote gender diversity in surgery. This has become a personal mission of mine in the past decade, and I have worked hard to call out issues like manuals in urology and, frankly, terrible cultures in some institutions or departments, which mean that talented young women will not be attracted to do surgery. Sometimes this is just a large blind spot, sometimes more of an ingrained cultural bias. Whatever. Current and future leaders need to constantly ask themselves, are we creating a gender diverse workplace? Is this a place where talented young female trainees will want to work? For if you don't, then you will end up with a narrow gene pool lacking in gender diversity. And many people, me included, will not want to work in that environment. Avoiding personal obsolescence means you should also take a broader view and make sure that you are creating a diverse, open, attractive culture that the best and brightest will want to work in. And that means you need to make sure that you attract fantastic young women into your specialty. So I finish by returning to this Rembrandt and considering the evolution of the cancer surgeon. From the barber surgeon then to the molecular anatomist now, working in a multidisciplinary team with a strong and diverse culture, focusing on the disease, not on the technology, communicating and engaging. And I leave you with this quote from Henry Ford. Obsolescence is the very hallmark of progress. Although we might want to personally avoid obsolescence, we should not resist it more broadly. And therefore, lifelong learning is the philosophy that will keep you and me relevant and avoid obsolescence, perhaps for a little while longer. Thank you very much.